politicians be preachers. Be believers, be leaders. Be astronauts, be champions. Be truth seekers. Be students, be teachers. Be politicians, be preachers. Be believers, be leaders. Be astronauts, be champions.
Good evening, viewers, and welcome to the second edition of Making the Case. I am your hostess, Susan Rodrigues, and it is my pleasure to be here once again with you this week. After last week's program, I received a ton of messages and calls from supporters and persons who gave me encouragement to come back here this week again. Your outpouring of support and love was very encouraging, and here I am again for the second time with Making the Case. Tonight I have two young persons with me, fellow comrades of the People's Progressive Party, and they will be joining in the discussion. We'll be touching on several topics this evening: the economic situation, the no confidence motion, lack of opportunities for youths. So it promises to be a very exciting show, and that is what I aim for on this program. I strive to ensure that I provide the public with information that is reliable and that is factual, and at the same time, I want to make sure that you are entertained, and so the program is not boring while you receive the information that you need to receive. The persons with me tonight are unseasoned politicians, so very young in the party and very young on the political scene. Since 2015, or from 2015, this government, the APNU AFC administration, they have perpetrated the biggest fraud on the Guyanese people. Since the no confidence motion on December 21, 2018, things have been shifted into high gear. And suddenly all the projects that were once impossible or difficult to get done are getting done overnight. This shows the power of a government. This shows that if a government is willing to take care of its people, it can do so, and it can do so very seamlessly. And we should continue to hold government to that standard. Now, with that being said, let me bring in my guests this evening. To my immediate right is Dwayne Adams. He is a businessman, a dredge owner, a full-time business student at the University of Guyana, and a recently sworn-in counselor, only sworn in yesterday to the mayor and city council. Welcome, Dwayne.
Thank you, Susan.
And to my extreme right is Mr. Gregory Sokol. He is a computer scientist, a former captain in the Guyana Defense Force, and currently the Director of Operations at Blackfields Aerial Surveying, Inc. Welcome, Gregory.
Thank you very much, Susan, and good evening to all of our viewers tonight.
Yes. So I intentionally invited these two young men because after the feedback last week, people were very encouraged. Supporters of the People's Progressive Party, as well as outsiders looking on, they were very encouraged to see fresh faces. They were encouraged to see new talent and future leaders of the party. So I wanted to bring some new faces to you so you can see and judge for yourself the talent that is in the People's Progressive Party. Now, first of all, I want you to tell our viewers how now that we have most of our life was spent under the PPP administration, and then we have now had 4 years of the APNU AFC government. If we could start with Gregory, tell us how different life has been in your own personal experience, or maybe what you've witnessed with family and friends and so on. How different things have been from under the PPP's administration and now under the APNU AFC administration?
Well, Susan, over the past 4 years, since 2015, we've seen a significant shift in the business community. Mm-hmm. We have seen a lot of businesses not flourishing the way that they're supposed to flourish. Mm-hmm. I have a lot of friends who I talk to on a regular basis, businessmen, and the consistent complaint that I hear from them is sales are very low, things are not moving, the economy is very slow, and a few of them have actually had to close their businesses down.
Mm-hmm.
Because of the economic situation in the country.
Right.
And apart from that, those same persons that actually own businesses, they have now had to enter the workforce, and there's somewhat of a non-existent workforce in the country right now.
Lack of opportunities.
Lack of opportunities, lack of jobs. Some of them are unemployed, and unemployed meaning that they're actively seeking employment in the workforce, but there just doesn't seem to be, opportunities for qualified people, opportunities for persons who are not qualified but are still looking to make a living in the country.
Mm-hmm.
So we have seen that significant shift from 2015 for the last 4 years.
Mm-hmm.
And it is something that is very worrying in the country, and very worrying for young people in particular in the country.
Right. And I know, coming to you, Dwayne, I know you have been significantly affected since the APNU AFC coalition has come into power.
Definitely.
Tell us about that.
Adding to what Gregory was saying about the lack of opportunities, is also all these additional taxes that they brought on miners, even the regular business folk and on the road. It reached a stage where the small man just couldn't sustain it. You maybe breaking even. Sometimes you're not even breaking even.
And
you always have expenses.
Yeah,
in mining.
Mm-hmm.
There's always expenses. Other than that, the roads, it could say that under the People's Progressive Party, the roads weren't great, but they're always passable. From 2015 to when I transitioned out, due to the fact that I wasn't getting some land that I had applied for, because it was controlled by the syndicate.
Mm-hmm.
And we know who controls the syndicate.
Right.
No names need to be mentioned. And I kept trying. It was a lot of pressure.
Mm-hmm.
I had to transition out because I couldn't sustain it anymore. You couldn't pay your workers.
I believe you were even told that if you would like to continue your business,
yeah,
you have to become a card-bearing member of the syndicate.
And you, and that's not something that I really had any intentions of doing. So before I sold myself out, I transitioned out, and that's how I made the decision actually to go to the university and start furthering my studies a little bit.
Okay. Now, since the passage of the no confidence motion, the government has been extremely busy. What they have not been doing over the past 4 years is suddenly getting done quickly overnight. One of their biggest supporters, or the group that supported them a lot in 2015, was the youths. They appealed to the young people of this country. They came with many promises, and they're doing it again. They're appealing to the youths once again, whom they've forgotten for the past 4 years. So their newfound love for the youths by holding job fairs, concerts, etc. For example, the jobs now, I've seen this flyer come out. It says the Ministry of the Presidency presents Jobs Now, our inaugural job fair for 2019, that's being held this month. I mean, where was this all along? This is what you promised the youths all along. The fine print is that this registration is limited to the first 200 persons. So, you know, they're not going to find unlimited employment. So this is just for 200 persons, and it seems to be a register. It says registration. So there's no there are no specifics on this advertisement as to what type of job, the qualifications that persons need to bring or to have. So no description as to the employment that is being promised. It seems like a farce to me. It just seems like another hoax. And I know that the young people in this country are better than that. I know that the young people in this country are smarter than that, and they demand more from the government.
Yeah, so. Definitely. It's laughable, actually, because I remember the president himself going on national TV, and he's like, it's not the duty of the government to provide jobs for anyone. But
right.
Now, we're going to be in an election season soon, and once again, they're rolling out the promises. The promises of a good life.
Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah. In 2015, what we saw, when APNU was in opposition and they were campaigning at the time, they appealed to the youth voters. They appealed to the youths in the country. And one of the things that they said to us was this. They said to the youths, we will create jobs. We will employ youths.
Mm-hmm.
We will make opportunities available to youths. You vote for us, and
mm-hmm.
we will ensure that you're well taken care of. So the elections went through. APNU AFC coalition, the APNU won the elections. They got into power. A series of things happened after they got into power.
Mm-hmm.
And then what we started to see was they started to appoint ministers, junior ministers, and they appointed all these persons that were aged. That they were older folks.
Mm-hmm.
So the youth said, okay, maybe there is something else for us. Maybe there's a plan for job creation for the youths. And 4 years later, we have not seen any of that happen,
mm-hmm.
right? So in my opinion, what I saw happening was that the government today appealed to the youths for these votes, and they just left the youths hanging. And left everybody out there, and then no jobs were created. So at this 11th hour, what we see here with this flyer with jobs now, after passing of the no confidence motion, we see jobs now. They're saying to us, come, we have jobs, we can sign you up, we can give you jobs, but where were these jobs all the time? Are they gonna pull these jobs out of thin air? There was no movement in the economic sector. There were no sort of manufacturing. Let's just use manufacturing
mm-hmm.
Sector. The manufacturing sector wasn't functioning, and no jobs were created. So now, at the 11th hour, they're coming with all the promises, saying, "You know what? We have jobs. Come to us."
Mm-hmm.
And the flyer that you just showed the viewers, it's not very specific. Are they creating jobs? Where are they creating the jobs? In what
mm-hmm.
sectors
what
are
sector.
They? What sectors are they creating the jobs? So you know they have different levels of skilled and unskilled workers in society. So who are they really appealing to? And who should come to this enrollment session that they will be having? So again, as we see, you know, I think that is just another farce that's being put out there, and another way to try to trick youths again. You know, elections is coming up very soon, and maybe we can appeal to the youths again to come on board with us.
Yep. Now, you see, we understand, we are not seasoned politicians, we don't have all the answers. But we know that a government provides a certain amount of employment. When that has been exhausted, there were always opportunities to provide employment through investment. We have seen no new investment under this government, and that is a fact. There has been no new investment, no new foreign investment under this government. Businesses, people are not coming into this country to invest. And this is how, this is a great way that a government can encourage people to come into the country to create employment. So, and we've heard it in the media, and many of you sitting at home, you know, ExxonMobil, CGX Energy, Repsol, Troy Resources, Movietone, Qualfun, Teleperformance, Ghana Gold Fields. All of these companies, all of these investments are PPP projects. These are all PPP projects. Yeah. And these places, I can go on, the list goes on and on. These places provide thousands of employment, thousands of jobs for young people, for talented people. And we have seen none of this, no movement in this area under the present administration. And apart from persons not being able to go to work and take care of their family, we are seeing a lot of social problems developing from lack of employment. And we know what they are. We open the newspapers every day and we see what's going on in homes. We see a lot of domestic violence, people addicted to alcohol, drugs. The crime rate is spiraling, even though the minister is denying that crime is on the rise. And these are all social ills that are a direct result of people not finding employment.
Yes.
So, you want to tell us about that?
What we see, and it's a simple Google search that you can check and see stats and see various studies that were done.
Mm-hmm.
Where the relationship between unemployment and crime is very significant. You find them in societies where there is very high rates of unemployment, you will find very high crime rates in those societies. And what we see is that is exactly what has started to happen in Guyana. It's slowly creeping in here because the unemployment rate is going up and crime is on the increase as we see it. But government has a responsibility to deal with that. They don't have a responsibility to incarcerate because that is a very short-term solution for long-term issues that that we are having. But the government needs to create policies. They need to, let's say, start projects to make employment available to persons so that we can see a reduction in the crime. Because if somebody is unemployed and they have the opportunity, not everybody I'm saying, but when you see certain persons are unemployed, sometimes crime becomes very attractive to them. And that is something that the PPP would like to change when we get into power. It is something that we understand that there's a very high unemployment rate in the country. So the government needs to create policies, they need to find ways to create jobs in the country. They need to start social programs, get people to understand that there are opportunities, we can create opportunities for you, and train persons, give them skills, equip them with skills to go out there and find some sort of employment or be employable, at least be employable.
Right.
Yeah, well, if I could share a story with you, I really like sharing this story. It was a couple of years ago, we were doing a walkabout in the Campbellville housing scheme area.
Uh-huh.
And we approached a gentleman. We were verbally abused, myself and another comrade. So we left, and about 5 minutes later, the gentleman actually came looking for us. So he started asking questions like, who's speaking at your meeting? Is Jack Dio speaking at your meeting? Like, no, sir. It's like, whenever Jack Dio is speaking at the meeting, you tell me, because that's a man that has a vision.
Yeah.
He always makes sure that everyone has, as he said, food on the table.
Mm-hmm.
And that's something that you're clearly not seeing under this government. It's back to the good life, but it's only the good life for a few. And we know the few is their select few.
You see, this crime situation and what's happening in this country, this is what brought the young people of this party. This Gregory, for example, he joined the party just in January of this year. We are at home If you had asked me 3 years ago if I'd be doing this, I would tell you no. I joined the People's Progressive Party while they were in opposition. I had a look at what was happening for the first year under the APNU AFC administration. It didn't take me long. It took me about 6 months to realize that these folks are no good for Guyana. I mean, the first huge mistake they made was to increase their own salaries. You know, that did not go down well at all. That was a bitter pill to swallow. And their excuses were very lame. Yeah. So that was the first thing. So it only took me about 6 months, and I thought, this is not right for Guyana. This is not good for Guyana. We made a mistake, and we need to correct it. And so I stepped out. I did not have any political background. Nobody in my family were ever members of the PPP or any political party. You know, I walked in and I wanted to join the party, and I was welcomed. I'm a member of the Camerville group. The first year that I was an ordinary member, the second year after elections were held, I was elected the secretary for the group. And then the third year, which is this year, I was elected the chairman. I'm the sitting chairman of the Camerville group, which I love to boast this is one of the most powerful groups in the People's Progressive Party. Dwayne is a member of the group and the current secretary. And so it's been a wonderful opportunity for me. I have always been respected in the party for my ideas, my talent, and what I can bring to the table. And I have never been held back because I'm new, and there have been people there who, you know, seasoned politicians who've been there. The membership of the Campbell group includes the general secretary, Dr. Roger Luncheon, Dr. Barry Ramsaran, former president, Donald Ramatar. You know, they're in the group. I am their chairman, and I am the first female chairman of the Camberville group. And I can't express how proud I am of that. And you know, there were no impediments to me moving up in the party. And I, that's why I'm so excited to bring these guys to the viewers tonight too, because it's the same for them. They were looking on. They saw a great injustice being done. Our democracy is being undermined in this country, and we're not going to sit back and let it happen. And whenever the elections are held, it's either the PPP are going to win this election or the coalition is going to win the election. Let's not fool ourselves. This is going to come down to these two parties. So we have to decide, where do we want to be? What is the best, which party is the best party to take Guyana forward? We're not coming with empty promises. We have done this before. You have seen our track record. The people out there know what we can do. They know they always had money in their pockets when the PPP were in office. It is not so now. Then there are things like discrimination and so on that people are so afraid of now. People were free to express their ideas under a PPP administration. You know, a few days there was a protest going on somewhere, and you know, people were free to express themselves, and that is good. We encourage that because it holds the government accountable, and that is what we have to do now as well. Hold government accountable. We cannot go and vote for a government and put them in there and they take our votes for granted. We are not things to be used and discarded while you fill your pockets and lie to us and come with your empty promises. Our vote has power. We have power. We put you there, we can remove you from there. We see the corruption every day. The just last week we saw the corruption in the housing scandal. Minister Valerie Adams Patterson, minister yes. within the Ministry of Communities with responsibility for housing, awarding contracts to her husband. And then the excuses are so insulting. You know, she said she didn't know that or she's not responsible for awarding contracts. And then lo and behold, pictures surfaced where she was signing. You know, she is actively involved in signing and awarding these contracts. Only today we saw another example of that. Breaking only today, Video Mega Productions awarded a multi-million dollar contract to produce brochures and radio and TV public service announcements for the Department of Energy.
And who's affiliated
the
with
the company is owned by Minister of Public Telecommunications, Ms. Kathy Hughes. You know, and 4 years after becoming a minister, and you go to the website for this company, and she's still listed as the managing director. Mm-hmm. I mean, where are we going? Where are we going as a country? Where we're just, they're just behaving openly like this. It's they're not even attempting to cover this up. A simple Google search, you go there, and she's a managing director of the company.
Yeah. It would be interesting to see how this particular one with the housing minister plays out. Because the media had reported that they contacted several persons, the minister,
mm-hmm.
The CEO for Central Housing and Planning Authority, and the CEO had indicated that they're looking into the matter, and it is a conflict of interest if the minister's husband was awarded a contract. So they have their own internal investigation.
But now you have a minister who
right.
owns the company herself, she being awarded the contract. So
right.
not even a spouse or a relative, or, you know, it's getting more brazen.
But it will be very interesting to see how these issues play out and the justifications that will come about for
mm-hmm.
these contracts being awarded. So we have to really sit and look and see what's going on. And the people out there, the people of Guyana, will see for themselves what is actually happening and the outcome of the investigations that will happen.
Hopefully, if there are any.
If there are any investigations.
Mm-hmm.
But the people of Guyana, they will see for themselves, and they're seeing it playing out in the media every day of these issues that are coming up now. And as we get closer to elections, you know, it seems that more of these issues seem to be arising.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Yeah, well, going back to the housing issue,
mm-hmm.
I had asked the question, how long has the husband been a contractor with his business? The answer is maybe a few months after the government got into power, he started this whole contracting service.
Yeah.
So clearly it was just another way for them to get money
for siphon off,
yeah,
and that's what they've been doing all the time. That's what they were busy doing for the past
it's
4 years.
Part of their legacy.
So now they're scrambling.
Yep.
You know, let's try to pick up the pieces, see what we can salvage. Let's delay the election for as long as possible. We're going to use all kinds of excuses. We're going to go to the courts. We're not going to do anything until we hear the outcome of the courts. When that doesn't work out, we go to GCOM. Let's blame GCOM. Delay the elections. House-to-house registration. That's the new thing now. That's the new tune being sung, and it's resonating with people. Because if you come to me and you say, look, the voters list is tainted, it has a lot of dead people on it, overseas-based Guyanese are on it, you know, we need to clean up this list before we go to elections, I would think that sounds like a valid reason to go to house-to-house registration. But is it? I mean, people need to go and find out the facts. And the fact is that dead people do not vote, okay? I mean,
they should not.
Dead people do not vote. And if you finish, if you've closed off your operations, that today on this day at this time, we have removed all of the dead people from the list, somebody's going to die tomorrow. People die every day. There will always be dead people on the list. But as the General Secretary has proposed over and over again, if you're worried about dead people being on the list, there is a procedure to have them removed. There is a procedure to be followed. The GRO can simply provide that information and you can remove dead people from the list.
Yeah.
In addition to that, we can have scrutineers there. Let's have more scrutineers there to make sure that persons who are not supposed to vote are not voting. What else do we have? We have to sit and think this through, because there are people as well who are going to be disenfranchised by this house-to-house registration. And people are not seeing that aspect of it. They're just running away with this idea that we have to clean up the list, clean up the list. But what does that, really mean? And what are the consequences of that? I know, Dwayne, you can speak to that in the mining industry.
Yeah, because I did ask a question. They're saying that, okay, you come for the house-to-house registration. Let's say, okay, I'm in the interior. Am I going to be taken off the list? And what about at any one point, there's probably 70,000 to 80,000 men and women in the interior. So if during this process, you're not there, it sounds like they're all gonna be taken off the list. So they're speaking about youths being disenfranchised, but what about everyone else?
And we know the situation with the youths. As soon as you become 14 years old, you can go and apply for your ID card. And you will be placed on the national register. When you attain the age of 18, your name will be extracted from that register and you will be put on the voters list. It's better we have more people on there and make sure everybody is covered, and we have our scrutineers there on election day, and we make sure that people who are eligible to vote can vote. That is a better way to do it than taking people's name off the list. You don't want to disenfranchise people. And I think, Gregory, somebody expressed a very serious concern with this only today. And I would like also the viewers to understand some of the consequences of this house-to-house registration.
Right. Now, one of the GCOM commissioners, Mr. Alexander, wrote a letter today in the newspapers responding to a letter that Mr. Nandalal wrote.
Mm-hmm.
Regarding house-to-house registration. And one of the points that he made in that letter was the significance of the physical house-to-house registration, being that when they go to each house, they want to check that Dwayne lives at lot X,
mm-hmm.
he resides there, so that they can put that on the list. Now, he spoke about the miners, but we have a large seafaring workforce out there.
Mm-hmm.
We have persons working on the oil rigs. We have persons who are fishermen that are out there. We have persons working on cargo ships that leave Guyana regularly.
Right.
Yeah.
We have persons working on cruise ships.
Mm-hmm.
So we have about, and the figure that was discussed today, we have about 5,000 persons who are in the seafaring workforce that will not be physically present at their homes or where they're residing at that point in time.
Mm-hmm.
To be part of that house-to-house registration process. So GCOM needs to say to us, what will they be doing where those persons are concerned? What would they be doing where the seafaring workforce is concerned? Will they be registering those persons?
They have not made a proper proposal on how they plan to go about this house-to-house registration. And that is why the People's Progressive Party is resisting very strongly house-to-house registration. There is nothing sinister about resisting house-to-house registration. We are bringing it to you. We're telling you this is what will happen. People will be disenfranchised. People who are lawfully on that list of voters will be struck off. Their names will be struck off unlawfully. If somebody just travels during that time or goes away, or we have a lot of Guyanese who go to the U.S. and spend 6 months, they're not residents of the U.S. They're not even green card. They're not citizens and they're not residents. They're not even green card holders. And they are eligible to vote in our elections. They are Guyanese citizens, and you're going to remove them from the list?
Yeah, what are we going to do about them? You know, what are we going to do? What are they going to do when the process starts?
And the process is unnecessary. So it's not that we need to correct some huge ill or a huge wrong we're trying to correct. This is unnecessary. This is another way to delay the elections, to take us into 2020, and possibly take us beyond that, because, you know, the government, they don't seem to be willing to go to elections, and we know why. They know they do not stand a chance at the next elections. They have failed. They have failed miserably. And so Before we move on, I just want to remind the folks who are now joining us. Tonight we are discussing a wide variety of topics. We have new comrades here with you. We're introducing you to new faces, hopefully the future leaders of the People's Progressive Party. I would like you to stand by, give us a call. The numbers are on the screen. We're going to continue discussing further issues, and as soon as we go to the phone lines, we'll take your calls. Please join in the discussion. Young people, if you are up, call us, give us some feedback. You don't have to be a young person alone to call. Anybody can call. The numbers are on the screen. I want to discuss a very, very touchy issue, but it's something that we should talk about, and that is race.
Yes.
We know growing up in the past, we hear our parents and so on talking, grandparents talking about this division, this race division. Now, speaking for myself personally, I have never experienced racism. I have never been racially prejudiced against anyone. I do not believe that in 2019, race has any place in our society and that race has any place in any political discussion. I think we are far past that. And I think that Guyanese are more than capable of setting race aside and voting on issues. And you know how I know that? I know that because we did it in 2015. Indian voters, Afro-Guyanese, Amerindians, Portuguese, those persons, nobody looked at race. We went to the polls and we elected the coalition government. Guyanese are more than capable of voting regardless of race, where they are capable of voting based on manifestos, made on proposals made by political parties. We did it before and we can do it again. Check our manifestos of the past. Check the manifesto that will be coming up for 2019 or for 2020, whenever the elections will be held. Listen to our speakers, listen to the proposals and our plans. Make your decisions based on that. That is all we are asking you to do. You've had a chance to see what the coalition government will bring. You saw their empty promises. You know what the PPP did and can deliver. And look at our proposals this time around. And you make that choice for yourself. I want to ask you guys, I mean, that's how I feel about race in this political discussion. I know that online, you know, we still see some persons attacking each other based on race, but it's few and far in between, and I just want to state my position unequivocally when it comes to race. What do you think?
Well, I share your view, Susan. And again, if you allow me to share a story.
Sure.
This was during the local government election. So we were campaigning and we went to Stabroek. So I was speaking to a vendor. She was, you know, friendly. Mm-hmm. And then she started asking, where are you from? Why don't you go back to your country? Why are you meddling in the business of Guyana? I'm like, I'm Guyanese. And she started laughing, and I had another comrade with me. Well, she started picking on him also. And then the other vendors, they were like, lady, you know, leave these guys alone. They're doing a job. Respect that. And she went on. But I thought it was uncalled for. It was one of the first times that I actually was verbally attacked like that. And
Time you were discriminated against?
Yeah, and I wasn't sure how to handle it. Because instinct is... Yeah. Is to you know, get defensive, and you'd want to answer them. I'm glad I didn't though.
Before we go to you, Gregory, if you don't mind holding your thoughts, we have a call on the line. Caller, you're on the air.
Good night, Susan.
Good night.
I'm enjoying your program. The three of you, we need to see Abu off on the TV.
Thank you.
Yeah, this is very nice, and I enjoy your program, right?
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
The gentleman, the business is true to say.
Yes.
It should be faced in Georgetown. It's very hard. Mm-hmm. Going down working.
Yes.
A taxi driver, right?
Okay.
and it's really unjust out here. I have no work in town. You got a family to maintain and bless the day and get in easy.
Mm-hmm.
I would like to evict from the Freedom House. If you can be a part of the gap on the way you are, start on the TV, in time and out, just keep the treaty card and people are terrible.
Okay.
And you need to change the attitude. He and a bunch of them
okay.
will be back.
All right.
Thank you very much.
All right, thank you, caller.
Okay, goodbye.
Bye-bye. Yes, so I, like I said, I know people, our own supporters, as well as persons looking on, they love to see young persons come out and we show our talent, we show that we're willing to work and that we're standing up for what we believe in. And we believe that the People's Progressive Party can do good for Guyana. So Gregory, back to what we were discussing before.
Yeah.
We were talking about race.
I want to share the same sentiments that you and Dwayne just expressed here. And I agree, and race has no place in politics. This is 2019, and our party is, we brought new persons on board,
mm-hmm.
fresh faces on board, and there's no place for race in politics. What we really need to look at is issues, and vote on issues. Look at what the party is putting out there. Look at what the PPP is saying to the people of Guyana, and the issues that we want to deal with. Let me give you a quick example.
Sure.
In Jamaica, Jamaicans don't refer to themselves by any race. They
mm-hmm.
call themselves Jamaicans.
Mm-hmm.
And they're still a very young country, and in the general scheme of things, like us, and we need to get there.
Mm-hmm.
We need to get there, and the only persons that can change that is us,
mm-hmm.
and the younger generation of politicians. We need to change that perception of you know, race meddling in politics, and you know, it's only a race based votes. And as you rightly said, in 2015 we saw that when persons went to the polls and they elected the coalition government. It wasn't the Afro-Guyanese alone that voted,
mm-hmm.
the Indo-Guyanese voted, the Chinese who were Guyanese voted, and the APNU, the coalition, they were very successful. So we've started to see a shift
mm-hmm.
in that, and persons wanting to vote on issues out there. So I agree with you, and I agree with Dwayne totally, that in 2019, race has no place in politics.
Right. The PPP is an inclusive party, and I plan to put that on full display. So I want people to see and to assess for themselves. Don't take it from us. You don't have to take our word for it. You will see for yourself, and you can judge for yourself. I think we have a caller on the line.
Hello, good evening.
Hello, good evening. You're on the air.
Yeah, good evening, dear.
Good evening.
Yeah, I'm listening to the program and I'm really enjoying the program and I appreciate everything that you're saying, right?
Okay, thank you.
But
thank
being
you.
A Guyanese, and I'm not a politician by any means, but being a Guyanese, one of the things that I will really love to see parties, like both of our political parties do,
mm-hmm.
right, is to bring God in the picture, because all I hear is the opposition or the government, they, you know, they talk, you never hear nobody talk about God. And you know, in everything, we need to have God in the midst. We need to put God in the midst. And, you know, God can change everything. As
uh-huh.
much as we know that the PPP, C Party, has done a lot for this country. Because I am from Essequibo, and I tell you what, the road that we had here before 92, people used to call them back dam roads.
Mm-hmm.
And the development that we have
yep.
seen on the Essequibo ever since the PPP government came into office, it's tremendous. And me being a half Afro-Guyanese and half Indian, I visited the area on the Eskimo Coast for job because he's related to my father. And
mm-hmm.
five times I visited him for jobs, and on all five occasions he told me that he don't have time to talk to people on those days.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So as much as I'm saying, and I'm saying it's okay, I'm a supporter of the PPC party, but one of the things I really love to see, that's whether Hindu, Muslim, Christian, I would really love to hear us, you know, bring God in the picture, you know, let God take over. When God take over, you know, I mean, we know that everything will be well.
Okay.
I wish you all good luck, and you all are doing a very good job. Continue the good job.
Thank you.
Thank you
very much, caller. Now, the our constitution says that we are a secular state. So, but God is omnipresent, and whether you are Christian, Muslim, Hindu, it's one God. So we don't, of course, we could bring God into the conversation. Yesterday, I was at Dwayne's swearing-in ceremony and at the council, and I was surprised that we began with prayers. You know, we said we were led in prayer first, and then we said the pledge.
Pledge, yep.
So there, we do remember God, of course. I am a Catholic, and so I was trained to, at least what we do, we practice, when you want to pray, you go behind closed doors and you do it in private.
Yes.
That's my belief, and that's how I do it. But there are different ways to express it. What we don't like, what I don't like, is the hypocrisy of it. Mm-hmm. You know, like what we've been seeing, oh, President Granger is a good Christian man, and you know, all these things. And then his actions say otherwise. So certainly, I believe God has a should be on our lips. It should be in our discussions, and we should always say, God willing. God willing, we will do this. God willing, we will do that. But not to use His name at all.
But another very important point that you made there too, yesterday at Dwayne's swearing in,
mm-hmm.
was that they said the national pledge. And we need to bring that bit of patriotism back into Guyanese.
Mm-hmm.
And we should do it more often at events, at the beginning or the ending of an event. You know, say our national pledge. You know,
it is
bring
done
back,
a lot. You
bring
know,
back
you know,
that
when,
patriotism.
When, yes, definitely. Now, I wanted to make one point. You reminded me when you spoke about Jamaica just now, and Jamaicans not regarding themselves only as Jamaicans and not as race. I experienced that when I was at university studying law. At that time, they had a lot of Belizean students studying law in Guyana because it was more affordable at
yes.
the University of Guyana than in Belize. And I saw this one of the guys. He was light skinned, kind of like Dwayne. He had green eyes, and I assumed maybe he was Caucasian. And I asked him. I said, "What race are you?" And he was really puzzled by that question. Like, he looked at me as though he doesn't know what I'm talking. He said, "What do you mean race? Like, I am Belizean."
Right.
You know, and then it struck me. I said, you know, like, we have really been going about this thing wrong in Guyana, you
Definitely.
Know, describing
Definitely.
People by
Definitely.
How they look or they hear or what color, the color of their skin. So that was very eye-opening for me. And that's our neighbor. Jamaica is right there. Belize is right there. And they got it. We need to get it
yes.
right. We have
another
caller. Caller, good evening.
Hi, good night.
Good night.
Good evening.
How are you?
Fine, thank you. How are you?
Good. Susan, you know, good job.
Thank you very much. Anything else?
Just keep on doing your job.
Okay, I will do so. I will do so.
Do your job.
Thank you. All right. Thank you for coming through.
Have a nice day.
Bye. You too.
Susan, you have a fun.
Caller, you're on the air.
Hi, Miss. Good night.
Good night to you.
Hold on. That's so long. Stay here a little bit.
Okay.
Yes.
Hello? Hi. Go ahead.
Good night to the panel.
Good evening.
Good night to you.
Yeah. And I want to big up Mr. Gregory. When he says about Jamaicans, people in Jamaica, they say them as Jamaicans, and therefore we in Guyana had to realize we Guyanese are
mm-hmm.
like
mm-hmm.
me again, no race. I don't know who is me.
Mm-hmm.
So when people say that people voting for race, I don't know why you should vote for.
Who should?
And this
caller is so right, because now we are so mixed up in this community, and it's wonderful. It's wonderful to see the light skinned people with the curly hair, and you know, we are Guyanese. We're not
yeah.
describing people who's Afro-Guyanese or who's Indian or Dogla or, you know.
Right.
We're
right.
Guyanese.
Right.
Yes.
Yeah, and we should report
it affects me, like, when some people from the opposition that's come and say about race, and it vexes me with people in the government that's come and say about race.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And it bothers me. Well, if these people are talking about voting at race, I don't know who I should be interested in.
Mm-hmm.
I think what we should do, come together as one, as we Guyanese, and look for put the country forward.
Absolutely,
help
absolutely.
The poor people.
Mm-hmm.
I vote for the coalition because they say that they could do X, Y, and Z,
mm-hmm.
and they totally fail.
Mm-hmm.
Now I had to put my vote somewhere else because poor people keep suffering more than what I was used to. But in the past administration, right, people who used was living a better life than what we is at present today. So I want to big up the past administration, and I think I go vote for the past administration this go around because
okay.
this government fail a lot.
Okay, caller. Thank you.
And once again, this race thing, what they're talking about, vote, they should stop this thing. This thing does vex me, and I think it vexing a lot of people. So they don't need to mention this thing. Racing them out.
Yes, it upsets me too.
It upsets, and I want to mention something before you cut me off. When they say race, it like it arc up something.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
When you come and see what you're gonna do, I think you should focus what you're gonna do and help your people. Don't bring this
Absolutely.
Race thing because
Absolutely.
You change the whole scenario of this thing, race thing.
Yes.
You understand?
Yes.
You drive people to something else. Well, if you understand, I'm going really attractive.
Yes,
you,
yes,
right?
I do. Very much so.
See what they're going to do for help the people and help the country, because we have so many resources. And next thing too, we have so many resources to live in this kind of life. People had to cut and run. We should be glad, like Trinidad, Jamaican, all in place. These people are proud, them is Jamaican, Trinidad, and
mm-hmm.
We Guyanese get so many resources, and we even proud we Guyanese. We got to cut and run.
Mm-hmm.
Some places we even have so many resources living a better life than what we live in.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So we need to come together and fix this place so that who abroad should come back and invest and don't have to free it, man. Just come back and live a nice life.
I agree.
We all are Guyanese and we respect we are Guyanese. This is a beautiful land and we should love it. And live it.
And build it. We will build
Correct.
It together.
Right,
yes.
right. So let it don't mention this race thing again,
mm-hmm.
man.
Mm-hmm.
Please.
I agree with you. All right, caller. Thank you for coming through.
That's a really, really positive input there from that caller.
Definitely.
It's very, very positive.
But he is coming back to the same thing what I was saying. That's why I was so confused and upset. Like, you're telling me about skin color. I'm Guyanese.
Yeah. He may not see a lot of Portuguese because
yeah,
you know the Portuguese have been in decline because and because of the growing mixed race,
right.
the growing mixed population that is in this country. Now you know who you're talking to people about race and they have you know they have all some people have all six races in them. They can't identify
yeah.
one way or the other. The only thing that we all have in common is that we were born in this land.
Yeah.
We're Guyanese. And we want to see better for Guyana. I certainly do, and that is why I took up this cause. This is not easy for me. I know Dwayne was sweating blood before this program started. He was very, very nervous, and you know we did it. We're here. Yes, and you know it's not easy for us, but we come out and we do it. We put ourselves at risk. Our families sometimes, you know, we put ourselves out there and on social media, persons will attack us, they will attack our character, they you know, in all sorts of ways. But we know that the cause is bigger and the cause is greater. And we want to take Guyana forward, we want to do it for ourselves, we want to do it for our children, we want to make sure that Guyana becomes the paradise that we know it can be. People are rushing to come to Guyana, and Guyanese are running out. you know, this mm-hmm. something is wrong with that. We have another caller on the line. Caller, good evening. Hello? Can you turn down the volume of your television, please?
Hi, good night.
Good night.
Good evening.
We're talking on the topic of race, right? Are you hearing?
Yes, go ahead. We're hearing you.
All right. If the African is going to say he is the first person on the earth, or the Indian is saying they are the first race on the earth, let me say the race, right? You get me?
Yes.
Right. Mm-hmm. Or the Amerindian say he's the first race. They're, everybody's claiming they're the first race on the earth, right? Why would they have a problem with the rest of races? Because if they're the first race, it means that the rest of races have to be coming from them.
Mm-hmm.
Correct?
The
rest of races originated after them. That means they are the seed of them. So
right.
Why should the first race have a problem with the rest of races? Because they're the parents of the rest of races.
Look, we're all one family. We're one human family.
Right. So you see the ignorance in racism.
Mm-hmm.
Because if the African is the first race, it means that the Indian, the Amerindian, the Chinese all originated from him.
Right.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
And if the Indian is the first race, the rest of races originated from the Indian. So the rest of races is the children of the main race.
Yes.
So the whole idea of racism is total ignorance.
And you see, if we keep firmly rejecting this, our politicians can't come to us with this.
No, the politicians using racism as a tool. They themselves knows that racism.
And that's why I'm saying we have to resist it. And
yes,
we have to resist
have to,
it in all its forms. We have to resist it when people talk to us in the minibuses, on the street, on social media. Everywhere we go, we have to fight it.
Yeah, but the only way you can resist it, you have to educate the people there.
Correct.
The people have to be educated that if the African man is claiming to be the first person or the first race, right? All the rest of the races have to be coming from him because he is the original person. If the Indian is going to claim he's the first race, the rest of the races have to come from him because nobody else can come from outer space.
Okay.
They have to come
All
from
right.
the first person.
Correct.
Right? So
okay.
where is the ideology of racism? There are different races come from. Is the politician bring that out to segregate the people so they can rule, divide the rule?
Mm-hmm.
Right?
And we will fight that. With your help, with many others like you, we will fight that.
Yeah, but you got to educate the people, and I want you to teach them that the doctrine of racism is a totally, fully of ignorance. Because if I'm claiming I'm African and I'm the first person that God created, all the other races have to come from me because nobody can come from outer space. I have to create the rest of them.
Okay, caller. Thank you. Thank you very much for coming through.
Okay, thanks for that.
All right, so the operator just indicated to me that we are out of time. I can't believe an hour went by so quickly.
It was very, very
Yes, let's we have to wrap up. Gregory, your final thoughts before we go?
Yes. Joining the party recently, before joining the party, I had to take a hard look around me
mm-hmm.
and what's going on and what my contribution would be to taking this to the country and the development of the country, and that made me join the party.
Mm-hmm.
And what made me more excited about joining the party was meeting young people like yourself and Dwayne and interacting with other youths within the party on a regular basis, doing the work on the East Coast, because I'm part of the East Coast group
right.
that's out there.
Mm-hmm.
And interacting with the youngsters within the party and seeing their energy and seeing how excited they are about, you know, getting
mm-hmm.
the People's Progressive Party People's Progressive Party elected in the next elections.
Correct. Okay,
yeah,
thank
definitely.
You, Dwayne.
Well, I share Gregory's sentiments. I've been in the party for a few years, maybe around 4 years or so. And it's the same thing, you know, there's scope for young persons. They always want fresh ideas. They're always pushing. They're always promoting, encouraging, and that's something that we've not been seeing with the current government.
Yes.
It's all for their old stalwarts, as they call them. So there's no scope for young people, and that's why I always at the university I tell my young friends, if you ever want to get into politics, the People's Progressive Party is the party you need to be with. Mere fact that there are opportunities, you will learn, you will be guided. It's not a my policy and you have to follow. You have ideas and you're more than willing to have those ideas heard and
other opportunities to move up.
Definitely.
Yeah. Yes. Okay, thank you. Thank you guys so much for being here.
Thanks for having us on your show.
Thank you for taking me through my second show and I took you guys through your first show.
Yes.
We had more things to discuss, but we ran out of time. So there you have it, folks. We hear people complain a lot about, you know, they're tired of seeing the same people over and over in politics. Three of us are here tonight, and we have stepped out on a limb, and there are many more of us within the party. We are hoping to take this country to new heights come the next election. We all want to play a role, and we want to make sure that we can do good for Guyana. We are only motivated by what we know we can bring to the table and what we know we can do for Guyana. Our intentions are pure, and if there are other young people out there watching us who want to get involved, do so. Come into Freedom House. Ask for Gregory or Dwayne or Susan Rodrigues. They will give you my number. Call me. You know, I'll set up a meeting with you, and in whatever way you can help. It doesn't have to be in this way. Everybody has their own talents and their own time to give. It's completely volunteerism. And if you want to see the People's Progressive Party elected to office the next election, which we know will happen, come and join us and help us to get there and help us to fight this government that is no good for this country. So thank you very much. Please join me again next week, same time, same place. Have a good evening.
Good evening, everyone. Good evening. Yeah, you can be the greatest, you can be the best.